So today we are going to start scanning electron microscopy, which is another important branch of electron microscopy. As I mentioned last time, that many of the things are common between transmission mode and scanning electron microscopy mode. If you have any question about the topics, you may unmute yourself and ask the question at any time. So the basic differences between conventional TEM and SEM, we already know, but just to summarize some important points, I've highlighted those points here, that rather than broad and static beam used in TEM, SEM beam is focused to a fine point and it scans line by line over the sample surface in rectangular raster pattern. So if this is your sample, so in standard conventional TEM, the electron needs to transmit and then you collect the transmitted electrons for various purposes, whether it is bright field, dark field, hadoop or x-rays. All the rejectors are at the other side, nothing is at the, so you have the lens systems also, very strong lens systems in TEM here. So that makes the size of TEM much larger than SEM. And also TEM is much more sophisticated in comparison to SEM because of the lens system is quite, quite a lot. I mean, it's two times than the SEM. SEM, the lens system beyond the sample, there is no need. So that makes the SEM cheaper than TEM, and it makes it simpler and smaller and compact. So here you have a pointed electron beam which moves, which actually scans line by line. Suppose if I draw the top view of the sample, so basically it moves, electron beam moves like this. So it when it moves, basically it collects the data at different spots. So it bombards electrons at a pixel, and it collects the data. When I say data, we'll come to that, what kind of data points. But normally the signals are primarily are secondary electrons and of course backscattered electrons and X-rays primarily. And you can do electron diffraction also. So more number of spots per scan line, you have much more resolution actually. So the resolution depends upon not only the spot size, but also how closely, so you can magnify if you have more number of points on each. So it is similar to any scanning techniques. For example, scanning probe microscope, like microscopes like AFM and STM, there also we use raster scan. Second difference is that we do not need electrons to penetrate to the other side. So you do not need very high voltage. You can apply minimum amount of volts from 50 volt to 30 keV. Generally, it is around 10, 15 kilo electron volt. Okay, so a specimen can be in any dimension, and I'll show you that. It is quite, SEM is quite flexible when it comes to the specimen dimensions, and you can load many, many samples. Okay. These days, environmental control SEMs are available. So interactions between beam electrons and sample atoms in an SEM, let us discuss that important point. And because you have already have fair idea about basic interactions between incoming electrons and atoms. So as we know that those interactions between incoming electrons and atoms can be divided into two parts, electron-electron interactions and electron-nucleus interaction. So what exactly happens that when anybody has a question?
Sir, I have one, sir. Hello?
Yes.
Hello, sir. I'm unsure. I have one doubt, sir.
Yes, yes. I can't hear your voice. Can you speak loudly?
Oh, okay, sir. Sir, being like TEM has so many limitations, sir. So then
I
also,
can't
why?
Can't hear your voice, sir. So the question arises that why do we need TEM when we have FESEM, field emission scanning electron microscopes. So yes, you are right. For many samples, you do not need TEM. In fact, in many user forms for transmission electron microscopy, it is mentioned that why do you need TEM? Have you tried SEM or other technique? Because SEM is much simpler. But for so that is the justification. So TEMs are higher resolution, much higher resolution, and TEM can give you despacing, the lattice fringes. Electron diffraction is much important feature of TEM. Okay, so TEM gives you much clarity about atomic resolution, which SEM cannot give you. SEM only gives you a topography of the upper layer of the specimen. It does not go through the specimen. Yes, that makes TEM sample preparation more complex. That because SEM TEM sample needs to be very thin. But I fully agree with you, answer that yes, most of the things can be done by SEM as well. You're right. Any other question? Very nice question. I hope I answered you.
Okay, sir.
So as the student mentioned that you can do backscattered electrons. For example, you cannot do yields. I will make a slide actually on this, whatever students. I'm honestly, I don't have a slide which has clear-cut differences between TEM and SEM. Manisha, please remind me about this. Just send me one email because I forget. In the middle of the lecture, I have no way of noting it. So you can look at the topography, and we will see later on how the topography is recorded. Just for the time being, just take it for granted that topography can be recorded, and the size and shape and arrangement of particle can be easily looked at, same as in EM. Composition can be, you can have EDAX detector, the same as you can do in TEM. Crystallographic arrangement is not usually done the same way as it is done in TEM, but you have the backscattered electrons, when they go through the specimen, they can diffract. Backscattered electrons, when they exit the specimen, for example, you have a sample, and electrons, primary beam electrons, are coming here, and they are getting backscattered. So when they get backscattered, for example, from this volume, so all these backscattered electrons will interact with the atomic planes. These are atomic planes, and some of them will satisfy Bragg's law, and they can have they can brack diffract. So you can have a brack diffraction cone. Actually, you can have the diffraction actually, but it is more complicated because these electrons here are not following a particular. So they are basically following a zigzag path. Got it? In contrast to simpler way in TEM, TEM the beams are parallel. So it is much better to have a control over angle and calculate the angle and know where the electrons, diffracted electrons are landing. Here the electrons are actually following zigzag pattern when they are exiting. That makes a bit, but people do regularly use this kind of electron diffraction. It is very common. So if we look at simplified sketch of SEM, as I have mentioned that it is quite simplified. In fact, the name, as the name suggests, electron gun remains same. Electron gun remains more or less the same, that you have either thermionic emission or you have field emission. So either you heat the filament and generate the electron beam, or you apply the voltage and generate the electron beam. And as we mentioned earlier, field-emitted electrons are much better, and that's why FESEMs are much better than thermionic emission SEMs. And same is true with TEM also. And you have the anode where you apply the voltage, whatever is the voltage you wish to apply. For example, 10 kiloelectron volt. Here, as we earlier mentioned, that you don't need such a high voltage. Chote mote voltage se bhi kaam chal jata hai. Then now you need magnetic lens to you have a set of lenses here, and this is the main lens that you, scanning coils. So this is another magnetic lens which is responsible for moving this beam this way and this way. Okay, so this these are scanning coils specially designed to scan the electron beam over the specimen. So this is the specimen stage. You will see. Now you have these electrons bombarding onto a tiny area over the sample, and then you have varieties of electrons which are coming out. So when these electrons bombard, so you have electrons coming out of conduction band and valence band. So those electrons are actually picked up by those are called actually secondary electrons. So secondary electrons are primarily the electrons which are coming out of valence band and conduction band. And as you know that you don't need much energy to remove those electrons. So that's why SEM does not require so much of energy here. And these electrons, as any chemistry students would know, that those outer electrons which are there in the outer orbital, they are highly influenced by bonding and surrounding chemical environment. So they are not, they do not have any identity of the atom which they belong, which is very important. So that is the reason, we will discuss it in detail later on, that these electrons, secondary electrons, do not have Z contrast. They do not have any elemental mapping. They do not know. And another reason is that here to pull the electrons towards this detector, because these electrons are escaping. So secondary electrons, when the secondary electrons escape, we would like them to turn towards the detector. So there is a small amount of positive voltage which is applied here, which speeds up the secondary electrons. Even if there is any Z contrast, so that is erased because the energy is modified. So when the energy is modified, we do not know from which atom they are coming. And so So that's why secondary, so SEM images do not have as such any elemental contrast, okay, which we studied a lot in TEM. In TEM, we learned that the transmission electron microscope image has contrast contribution from three different sources. Number one, Z contrast, which is very strong. Number two, thickness. And number three, crystallinity contrast. So none of these contrasts exist here. None of these three contrasts exist here. So we'll see what is the main origin, only one origin of second electron, you know, reaching there is the topography. That's the only contributing factor here, which makes things simpler also, in fact. So if you do not, if you're not interested in crystallography and elemental mapping, if you're just interested how it looks like, so then you do not really need to go to the complexity of high vacuum and all kinds of things. And of course, you have electrons which can take U-turn without losing any energy. So those electrons are picked up by this donut-shaped concentric. You can see that this is concentric. This is optic axis, and it is placed in a very unique way. So it has a fairly large cross section, so it can detect many. It's very differently placed in comparison to secondary electron detectors. So we'll discuss whether backscatter electrons can land up in secondary electron detector, or secondary electrons can land up in backscatter electron detector, and why or why not, which kind of. So we'll discuss it, because many students over the last few years, they are interested in knowing some of these details. So I keep these slides handy because right now we don't have a blackboard teaching, otherwise it's very easy to teach. If I don't have any slides, so it is very easy to explain things on the board. So any question on this slide? So you can see that there is no optic system. There is no optic system below the specimen, and you can see it's very small, and that makes this sample stage fairly flexible. So you can make this bigger, and you can see that you can mount any type of sample, and you can make this entire sample environment much bigger. In fact, you can put anything actually here, from a mosquito to your food or anything. In fact, you can see that people try to study the composition, chemical composition of terracotta soldier, and they could design the SEM sample chamber to in such a way that you can mount entire soldier, and then you can rotate sample stage and image the material from different directions. Actually, so as I mentioned, that secondary electrons are ejected from conduction or valence band of the specimen. Okay, please remember that. Okay. So that means you do not need much energy. Okay, so that is the advantage here. And what is the sampling depth of all these techniques? We have been discussing this specific case, specific slide in the TEM classes also. So you can see that sampling depth of secondary electrons is somewhere around less than 10-15 nanometer or 15 nanometer, depending upon, it actually depends a lot on the energy of incoming electron beam and the topography of the specimen, and it also depends upon the type of atom, basically Z, the atomic number of the, so those three things. So that's why this range is very broad, and because does it matter? Yes, it matters, because when you look at the image, you would like to know whether what kind of what till which depth your secondary electrons are contributing. Of course, backscattered electrons are much higher in energy, so they can their sampling depth is much larger, so you can pick up the backscattered electrons fairly deeper. And X-rays can be picked up, again we have discussed this point, but I'm repeating it, to much depth, because they are photons and they do not interact as strongly as electrons do. So the logic I have given you, basic concept, so you can apply the, so you can see that I have marked this, all these techniques, that they are photon based, and photon based techniques, they have much larger sampling depth. Okay. So these things are summarized here, whatever I have mentioned, that these are the three factors: atomic number of the material being examined, higher atomic number material will absorb or stop more electrons, so smaller interaction volume, accelerating voltage, obviously that they will be able to, higher accelerating voltage, electrons will be able to penetrate much deeper, and then electron will exit those spaces. But it's not necessary that when the electrons can, high energy electrons can penetrate deeper, but they, the secondary electrons, if they have the same energy, they may not be able to escape the deeper levels, because the outgoing electrons should have sufficient energy to be able to escape those. So that's why there is a, you need to be careful. Angle of incident does matter a lot. That's why we change the angle of incident. We can easily do that in SEM. You can tilt the stage very easily. Is there any angular distribution of ejected electrons? Why this question is important, and some past student might have asked this question, because the question probably some student asked that, where should we put this ejector? Why should we put this at one corner? Why not somewhere else? That was the question students ask when there is an offline questions. The offline classes are very rich with the questions, and somehow this is the first batch in my teaching history where questions are not really coming that much, and I don't really see that good attendance also. Otherwise, most of the students used to be fairly disciplined. But there is a concern about discipline also in this batch. I hope it will improve.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, the previous slide, the picture one.
What is your name?
Sir, Ansar.
Ansar, okay. You are the only one who is asking questions. Welcome.
Sir, not that one, previous one.
Yes.
Sir, here you told it will vary from 50 to 500, no, sir, with the different topographies and Z means the atomic number.
Yes, yes.
Can you give some examples?
Yes, look at this. Yeah, it's actually the next slide. I was just coming to this. So you can see that. So if you see this, your sample is, for example, this is this. The topography of your typical sample, and this is the detector, and electrons have to reach here to be detected. Now, when your electron beam is bombarding this area, So you will see that this is suppose this is your sample is of platinum or palladium, same element. There is no problem. There is no change in the type of atoms. But if you notice that, and that's the reason that interaction volume is the same, but the assuming that interaction volume is same, but you can see that electrons will not be, electrons which are being emitted from here will not be able to reach to the Faraday cage. But this is not the this is not the answer of your question. Here, so this 50 to 500 angstrom variation is primarily because of the jet. Okay, and you see this in TEM also. You see this in TEM that that in TEM for polymers you can afford to take sample as thick as 200 nanometer. 200 nanometer. While for for gold, you cannot take more than 20 nanometer. So if you need to study the electrons, transmitted electrons, you can see that there is a 10 times difference from 20 to 200 nanometer. And we'll come to that. Remember the Ohmian structures of our lectures. So I'll take you deeper to this question that what is the reason that there is a 10 times difference when you take polymer samples or any high Z elements such as your gold, platinum, lead, and bismuth, polonium, and all kinds of things, tungsten, and tantalum, and all kinds of niobium. So because they scatter very strongly, okay, electron, you have to understand that electrons get scattered from Coulombian interaction. And Coulombian, so if an atom has more electrons, okay, so that means more Coulombian interaction. And so then they will get scattered more strongly. So that's the reason that there is a wide difference between if there is any carbon here, okay? So carbon will have, for example, this depth, and your gold and all those things will have this depth. Is it okay?
Okay, sir.
Because our periodic table is very diverse. So that's it basically shows you a diversity of the periodic table. So answer is that why this question arises, there are two reasons. One, I have already mentioned that where do you put the detector? Second reason behind the origin of this question is the elastic interaction in elastic interaction between electrons and electrons of primary beam and atoms, basically. There, actually, you can calculate the angular distribution, and we will do that in next lectures. Whenever you have elastic interactions, you can, in fact, calculate the angular distribution. But for inelastic interactions, you do not have any equation. You cannot predict. In fact, you can predict. You can do a simulation of elastic interaction, scattering cross sections, very easily, and we will calculate that when we'll find something. But actual emission process can be very complex here in a TEM because electrons can take all kinds of random path. So because when secondary electrons are being ejected out, so they can in the process of ejection. What happens is that there may be other collisions, other scattering from atoms which they are interacting in the ejection path, and that can deviate the outgoing electron. So that's why there is no simple cross-section model. You understand? Because it can be a random random walk. It can be a random walk because you are taking a sample quite thick. So answer lies here. So when this is the depth here, so obviously in this depth you have when electron is, suppose you electron has to let's take minimum one 50 angstrom. So when electron has to escape 50 angstrom this way in order to leave the surface and reach to the detector, so in 50 angstrom obviously it will encounter all kinds of atoms also, and obviously it cannot escape without any interaction, right? So this outgoing secondary electrons will encounter so many electrons, and then it can get it can die also there. I mean, it can just go into some other path. May never reach actually detector. That is also true. So it's not. That's why you can see that it is very approximate actually. So okay. So that's you have to basically consider that those limitations. Another practical point from the detector aspect. So this principle, this slide is the most important slide. So this gives this basic principle of sample imaging or secondary electron imaging gives it a more lifelike imaging. Actually, this is, if somebody asks you that what's the reason that secondary electrons images are much more lively, they appear as if I mean, you are shining a light from one corner, and you have actually a shadow effect. You will I think some of you might have seen. If you have not seen, you will see some of the representative images. They're beautiful actually. You can. So the reason is that, so for example, this area is hidden. You know, it's behind the hill, so this will be darker, and okay, because it's behind the hill actually. So this is a natural way we see the object, okay? And here this area will be much brighter. It's like, you know, you have a sun here and it is lighting up. So this is behind the hill, so this area will be darker, and this area will be somewhere in the middle when look at the lighting arrangement. So it's this principle, because here electrons will be able to escape easily from this direction and this direction, because this area you have the interface which is closer. You have much more. It's like, you know, in Kerala you have a lot of coastline. It's like a coastline actually. Okay. And angular distribution of emitted SE secondary electrons is also not important. Because we are applying actually a field here, we actually apply a positive bias voltage. So it's not important. For example, if this electron is ejected in this direction, so it will curve and it will reach here. They actually change their path because there is a positive voltage. Okay, so electron take this kind of path. If there is any electron reaching actually here, so this will take some path. They're pulled. So that's the reason that you lose any jet contrast also, because electrons, their energy get manipulated. So they do not represent, they do not have any identity of any of the atom which they originally belong actually. कहाँ से वो निकल के आए थे, किस एटम के पार्ट थे, उनको कुछ मेमोरी नहीं रहती है. एंड दिस इज फॉर सम फिजिक्स स्टूडेंट्स हु माइट बी इंटरेस्टेड इन मैग्नेटिज्म. आई सी सम स्टूडेंट्स आस्क मी क्वेश्चन ऑल द टाइम, सो आई थॉट टू सेटिस्फाई देयर इंटेलेक्चुअल हंगर आई पुट दिस स्लाइड हियर, दैट इफ यू हैव अ मैग्नेटिक सैंपल विद अ मैग्नेटिक इंफॉर्मेशन, व्हेन आई से मैग्नेटिक स्पेसिमेन मीन्स सम alignment of or some some exchange interaction, you have these domains. Okay, so then obviously the electrons which are emitting from these domains will be spin polarized actually. Their spins will polarize because of direction of the magnetic field. And if your analyzer is spin polarized, if it can detect electron spins of different directions, then you can in fact image the magnetic domain using SEM. And it is also possible in TEM, same way that incoming electrons which are coming towards, for example, a ferromagnetic sample. So the electrons which are passing through different domains aligned in different direction, where the spins are aligned in different direction, so they will have different kinds of, the Lorentz force, and you can easily image them as resulting from different parts of. So magnetism has a very good influence on electrons, and you can easily analyze it. Okay, why does not SE electron detect the PSC and vice versa? One of the, let's because it is more complex question, let's go step by step. So the reason is, first question is that whether this is your secondary electron detector, sidemen, this is your specimen. And backscattered electrons are much more ejected with much higher velocity, right? You will agree with me, because secondary electrons are much weaker, they don't have much energy. So they are less likely, by the virtue of high velocity, backscattered electrons are likely to go straight towards this path. And backscattered electrons are elastically scattered electrons, so they have angular information. So that's why this their flux is detected here. Okay, but secondary electrons, this voltage is not strong enough for to stop to backscatter electrons from, they don't turn into this direction. But there are other problems which we will discuss, and that's why this this design of the detector is not considered very good. This is called Everett-Thorne kind of detector. Now we have in-lens detector. In fact, a chemistry student of ISER, she attended once. I mean, there are many students who come from ISER also in offline classes. I'm not sure today in this online class. So she asked me about this question, and a lot of these slides I had to put to satisfy her queries. She asked me about the work function, the capability, whether we can image the work function. She's a chemistry student, but she used to ask very deep questions. So, in fact, these slides, you can see that they are enriched by students' questions only. When some student asks me some questions, then there used to be a new slide. So, vice versa, whether backscattered electrons can reach, secondary electrons can reach to the backscattered detector. Yes, they can reach, but that number will be minuscule, and they don't do much harm to the backscattered electron detector, but they will form probably an unwanted background, which you do not want, because backscattered electrons have very strong Z contrast, which does not exist in secondary electron detectors. As secondary electron detectors have very good, very strong topographic contrast, which is not there in the backscattered electrons, because it is symmetrically placed. It is not at one side, as you can see that. So it is symmetrically placed, so that does not give the backscattered electrons electron detector that unique advantage. But if you put the backscattered electrons at one side, so you can have, and it's basically needed also, because in backscatter detector, you are looking for chemistry information, basically, like you are looking for jet contrast. You don't want anything else actually. So that's yes, ma'am.
I have a small doubt, sir.
Yes.
Regarding you said BSc electrons have more velocity than SC electrons.
Yes.
Sir, see, when we impart some of the electrons from the electron gun, the velocity of the secondary electrons should be higher, no, sir, when they are coming back than the backscattered electrons, which are more deeper than the secondary electrons.
So, let me, I have all the material to explain you here. So for example, you have 20 kilo electron volt energy, which is your coming in the primary beam, 20 kilo electron volt or whatever, 10 electron. So backscattered electrons are those electrons which basically the same electrons which get kicked by the nucleus and like slingshot, and they change the direction without any energy exchange. So the 20 kilo electron volt in and same electron will be out, same electron. They have very high energy. Now it is basically for example, from here, for example, 1,000 electrons, started their backward journey. So not all 1,000 electrons will be able to reach, escape the surface without interaction. In fact, these backward going electrons, which have not lost energy, when they start taking their backward journey, so they will undergo a lot of other scattering processes. So they can also generate secondary electrons. In fact, we'll see in a moment actually. But some who are able to escape the sample by maintaining the same energy, they are truly called as backscattered electrons, and they have highest amount of energy, right? Because they have same energy. Huh? And secondary electrons are the electrons which are coming from valence band or conduction band. Okay, and obviously they have some escape velocity also. So some energy of out of 20 kilo electron volt will be, for example, given to, suppose this is your atom and this is nucleus and this is one electron which is orbiting outer electron. So some energy will be given to this electron, and some energy out will be used to free this electron out of atom, and then some energy it will be carrying in as kinetic energy. Mm-hmm. So they have a 5 to 50 electron volt energy only. There is a huge difference actually.
Mm. Okay.
The energy difference is tremendous actually. That's why you need to apply positive voltage here. कि भाई आ जाओ इधर आ जाओ उधर उधर मत जाओ है ना उनको बुलाना पकड़ता है पकड़ पकड़ के ना.
So, due to the positive energy or positive interaction there, they all accumulate in one direction, yes, towards, yes, the detector.
Yes.
Okay.
And they lose their directionality also, which is good and bad both. Actually, which is good because you get much advantages here. And anyway, they don't have much identity of which atom they are coming from. तो कुछ फर्क नहीं पड़ता, आप वोल्टेज लगाओ, यहाँ पर वोल्टेज लगा देते हैं, बट देर इज नो वोल्टेज हियर ऑन बैकस्कैटर्ड बिकॉज यू वांट प्योर यू वांट टू कैच द एटम फ्रॉम वेयर दे आर दे हैव टॉक्ड, जिससे बातचीत करके आ रहे हैं, राइट, उस एटम को सुनना पड़ेगा ना कहाँ से आ रहे हैं. सो बेसिकली सपोज दे आर कमिंग after talking to gold atoms, so there will be more scattering by gold atom backscatter, like scattering in comparison to zinc or copper or nickel, right?
Sir, without any positive or some attracting force, they will be scattered more, right, sir?
So secondary electrons, if you do not apply here positive volt, okay, so then the signal will be very weak here, because I'll show you. Suppose you do not apply any positive volt, so total electrons reaching here will be very only those electrons which are which have their scattering direction like this, they will only be able to reach to the detector. For example, electron is which is going like this will not be able to go. It will just go to somewhere else.
Sir.
Yeah, that's the problem. Very nice. Anybody else? एक ही लड़की ओनली वन गर्ल इज आस्किंग द क्वेश्चन फॉर एवरीबडी एल्स टुडे इज द यू नो आई थिंक वी आर सेलिब्रेटिंग वुमेन डे आई होप मोर वुमेन विल आस्क क्वेश्चन एंड ओनली वन वुमेन इज आस्किंग क्वेश्चन फॉर ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ ऑल अदर वुमेन
हां सर
ज्योति मैडम मनीषा निवेदिता ऑल वुमेन So now we'll dive much deeper into the subject, that what are the different parts of SEM. We already have some idea, and we'll do some dissection of TEM. In fact, when we do the dissection of SEM, our knowledge of TEM helps us, and when we dissect TEM, our knowledge of SEM also helps us. So there is not much difference. For example, the electron gun is the same, exactly the same. Okay, so in fact, you can see that field emission gun is much sharper here. If you see, this is much pointed, because then it is always very pointed, very much because you know electric field is much higher at a point. Okay, when you apply certain voltage, it depends upon the area as well, the radius and everything. So here you can have two kinds of popular materials. One is tungsten. Here, tungsten filament is very common, cheap, and this is for thermionic emission. So you can heat this filament, and then electrons start coming out. And this is a better version, lanthanum hexaboride. Those these are two standard materials. Many people have researched all kinds of possibilities here, but I do not see any product coming out. For example, carbon nanotubes and all kinds of other possibilities. But these are the main mainstay electron sources. And then you have what we call it Wehnelt cap. You can see it. So this is the Wehnelt cap, which is negatively charged. In fact, Wehnelt cap is negatively charged to focus the beam. I will teach it in TEM in detail. But for example, electron, when they are ejected, they are ejected in all directions. So when you apply, like it's like negative focusing. When you apply negative bias, they are repelled and they collimate at a point. Basically, they make a point actually. Then after that, you apply anode. So here on Wehnelt cap, it's a negative volt. So this is important for the people who are interested in the internal detail. Otherwise, for others, it is not really. It does not matter when it comes to the image analysis. Wehnelt cap and other detail really does not matter a lot. Fuel emission is becoming mainstay and fairly popular because of higher resolution and more clarity, higher, very high quality, and you can afford to have lower voltage as well, and less charging, and obviously less charging means better clarity, because if you have more charging effect of samples. So here actually samples are glued using a carbon tape. This is the carbon tape, and then you can glue it any kinds of samples onto the sample stage. And then most of the time, if your sample if it is non-conducting, then it is recommended that you deposit a thin layer of thin metallic layer. Okay, so there is a deposition system, magnetron sputtering, normally in the SEM room, where that coating is done on top of your sample. So when you want to reuse the sample after imaging, don't forget that it is already contaminated by those metallic atoms. So there is a thin layer. So please be careful. Unless you have specifically mentioned to the operator that don't do any coating, so you will get it back as such. So you can see that image resolution has gone to almost 5 angstrom. This is quite interesting, actually. So the lens system is...
Excuse me, sir?
Yes.
Sir, which material is most suitable for this thin coating of the sample?
Usually it is gold, palladium, and all kinds of things which are inert. Gold, palladium, or sometimes alloy, or sometimes just gold. And the thickness is around 10 to 15 nanometer.
Okay, sir.
So they are electron transparent. Electrons can penetrate through, because more than 50, 20 nanometer, I already mentioned that electrons may not be able to escape. So they are usually like 10 to 15 nanometer thickness.
Okay, sir.
So lens system, you have, these are two, this is aperture, and then you have condenser one, condenser two. We have already discussed that. So if somebody is interested, so you have, these are deflection coil to, double deflection coil. Earlier I used to teach this in detail, but nowadays I don't teach how this deflection coil works, because it's not very important for chemistry students. So I used to teach actually this double deflection coil principle. I used to teach stigmeter also. Stigmeter is a very important thing. I will teach what is stigmatism and how to correct it when you get hands-on training on SEM. Suppose some of you get. So this is one of the most important thing which you you learn, how to fix the stigmatism and all kinds of things. So then you have detectors. You can have energy dispersive EDS for X-ray analysis, and this is your old-fashioned secondary electron detector. So you have a photo multiplier tube, EMT, which amplifies, and then you go to the CR cathode ray tube. Which this is basically old design. Nowadays we don't have all these cathode ray and all kinds of things. This slide is very important. I think I have added one or two more slides which I did not. Yeah, this I never showed, I think, earlier, but this time I thought I'll unhide that slide. So some of the things I have already mentioned. So in field emission, you can afford to make spot size smaller. So spot size smaller does not solve the problem altogether. You need to have So when you have a smaller spot size, obviously it is good because your resolution becomes better because you are at a given time you are imaging only a small point, so you can resolve. That is your resolution. So resolution, a disclaimer, resolution is not just the small the spot size alone, because please remember that interaction volume. So when this beam enters into the sample, so and it generates the secondary electron, so it broadens actually. So outgoing secondary electrons will not be from the same tiny area, so that will be slightly broadened actually. So it is recommended that you make this beam as narrow as possible, because there is some amount of broadening within the sample, right? You have seen this. You can see that even if you make this beam narrow, so there is a broadening actually. There is a broadening. So there is always a broadening. So the electron takes the random path actually, right? But and this in this resolution is also a function of your type of atom, which are present in your specimen, because finally this random pathways which outgoing electrons which will be used in the secondary electron detector are governed by type of scatterings or type of interactions which are happening between outgoing secondary electrons and your atom and the crystallinity and everything else. So it is a complex system where your atomic number and everything decides the resolution. So there is no thumb rule. That's why there is no thumb rule that you can say that this is the resolution. So resolution depends also on your sample type. We agree with this. So you need to take more points also, not just the smaller to solve. So this is called dwell point. So if you the problem with the narrow beam is basically that you have less number of outgoing secondary electrons, so less signal is generated. But that's a trade-off. So if you see, there is a typo here. So here we are decreasing the spot size when we go along this direction. So this is, for example, 60 nanometer, 50, 40, 30, and this is 17. So if you zoom on your screen, you will easily notice that this image looks crisp in contrast to rest of the images. So that really proves that we need smaller spot size. So that answers your question about the resolution of SEM, right? So it answers the question that what are the factors on which the resolution of second electron microscope depends. I answered that it depends upon the spot size as well as your sample type also, and the topography also. So it's a complex answer. But primarily, you can say that it depends upon the spot size, the narrower the spot size, the better. Yes, the detectors. So detectors are becoming much more advanced, actually. Earlier, it used to be only one kind of detector, which we call as Everett-Thorney detector. So collector cage has positive voltage, so that electrons, outgoing secondary electrons can turn this way. So this is a standard detector which you find, but more so this has a problem actually, serious problem. So we'll come to that, and then so you can see that it's the actual picture of an SEM sample space, and you can see that there is a in comparison to DEM, there is a large amount of space here. You have vacuum gauge and backscattered electron detector, and these are the magnetic wall pieces. And this is EDS detector, Oxford. And this is your Everett Fermi detector. This one here. Okay. So so when you need backscattered detector, you can insert it like this. I mean, it's withdrawn. You can see that it's not okay. So normally you can move them. Some of them are fixed. Some of them are not required. So you can probably, some of the machines have this facility that you can. So this is the problem. So secondary electrons are of four types, primarily three types. So please pay attention here. Otherwise you won't understand. So we have been discussing so far SE1, which are ideal, which is an ideal case that secondary electrons are the electrons which are generated by primary electrons interacting with the sample. That's all. But this is not always the case, because backscattered electrons, when they are exiting the sample, they can also generate secondary electrons. So they are labeled as SE2. Okay. So normally what happens that these are also part of overall signal, not just this. So SE1 is anyway you need that's so this is undesired, but this does not, SE2 does not create any problem in your imaging. It does not create any problem. Problem is created by SE3, which are actually, suppose this backscatter electrons are they collide with the this guy here, lens system. So basically, so this outgoing electrons, they collide here, and then they generate this material, lens material, also generate secondary electrons. So that can also be picked up by this. All these, chamber matter. So those are not desirable actually, backscatter electrons. And same thing, primary electrons can also, primary electrons which are coming downwards from this hole, that can also, less likely, but this is very much likely. This SE1, SE2, SE3, they are fairly, they are fairly common actually. Similarly, you can have different kinds of backscattered electrons also, DS1, DS2, okay? So, that's the problem. So that's where this invention of IL lens versus regular lens, which is called ET, Everett Thorney detector design comes. So you can see that a secondary electron detector can attract all kinds of SE1, SE2, SE3, because it is positively charged. And this is the interaction volume, zigzag. They will take the zigzag path, which is described here. And they can all be pulled up here. So it is better described here, so that backscattered electrons will interact with pole pieces and then generate SE2. And SE1 and SE2, already they are coming from your sample. SE4 is highly unlikely, because it's to come from somewhere here, and then it is not very common. So then you have another detector, which is which you call in-lens detector. If you notice, in-lens detector is a concentric detector, like your backscatter. Backscatter detector, if you remember that it is backscatter detector is somewhere here. So it is similar. It's not like somewhere the side. So here you have better contrast of, so there you don't apply actually voltage. In-lens, you don't apply any voltage here. And So this this inline separator allows you to apply less. You know, you can work at lower voltages in the primary field. I mean, there are many advantages which I have listed out, and the resolution is better. So you don't need to. You can reduce accelerating voltage here, and this is inline LCD, secondary electron detector, and Everett Thorne detector. You can see that at, for example, 20 kilo electron volt, the resolution is almost 2 times better for inline detector in comparison to Everett Thorne detector, because this mass reduces the resolution, obviously. I mean, they want, see, for example, SE2 will not do any harm, but they will reduce the, I mean, they will increase the, that because they are coming from larger areas, so they will reduce the resolution. I hope you understand how, why the resolution will be worse, because the interaction volume, you can see that the zigzag path will be much, much more actually. So that's the reason that this is much larger. SE2, SE3 will worsen the resolution. Another, so you can, this is an example that shows palladium on carbon catalyst, and image on your left side is taken from, taken using a Everett Thorne detector, operating at, I mean, the electron beam is accelerated at 20 electron volt. And you can see that this is inline image where the accelerating voltage was only 1.6 kilo electron volt. You can see that the image is much better when, even when you have a, when you are using less than 1/10 of the accelerating voltage, just by changing to this new generation of lenses. So another interesting thing is that this was a question which student asked. You can produce work function dependent contrast. Beautiful, because you're not applying any voltage. So, and so work function is basically it depends upon your escape energy depends upon your work function. So because suppose you know what is the energy of the primary beam. For example, if you take the when I say work function dependent, there are many applications. I'm sorry, I'm not a very good artist here. So, for example, you have two grays and two. You have a composite and whatever. It can be hybrid system, or it can be composite system. It can be one material with different crystalline facet. And please remember that work function for a crystalline material is different in different lattice directions. So work function is always an anisotropic parameter. But forget about that. Even if you have two different materials, A and B, and in the sample, so work function of A will be different than B, then you can distinguish. Suppose topography is same of A and B, which is a thin film, fairly smooth. So this can be distinguished. Why? Because suppose this is your primary beam, and so the secondary electrons will the energy of secondary electrons will vary based on the work function. Earlier it was not possible because of interference from all kinds of SE2, SE3, SE4, and also you have a voltage which destroys all this subtle information. Second reason is, okay, but what else can still destroy this work function energy? Is suppose you have surface potential, suppose you have surface charge, which you are not controlling, which you are not removing. Suppose somewhere it is negative charge, suppose it is dielectric or metallic, then this surface charge will destroy your work function contrast. So you have to be very careful if you are interested in these kinds of things. So you must ground the sample very well. So, okay. So, but this is all possible here. So you can study from the slides in detail, and these things I will touch upon in next lecture. How to produce an image and using this. This is an involved topic. Lot of it I have already discussed. That how the image is produced. I mean how that image contrast comes. I mean, I've already showed you one very interesting this schematic. So, but we'll discuss this schematic much deeper. So, I leave you with this image of an object, which tells you what I was trying to tell you, that it is. It looks a true. Image, like, you know, it's very lifelike image. You can see that. So, any question?
Sir, I have one question.
Yes. What is your name?
Sir, Mayur, sir.
Yes, Mayur.
Sir, why can't